Welcome back to my video series on change detection in Angular. This is the third video in this video series, and today I'm gonna show you what is OnPush change detection strategy, how it works, and which problems it solves. And also, at the end of this video, we will try to visualize the change detection process in Angular, and we will have a look how it behaves when our Angular application has one or more components with OnPush change detection strategy enabled. If it is your first time on my channel, my name is Romoshensky, and here you can find a lot of advanced and in-depth Angular tutorials that you can check out later right after this video. But we are getting started, and let's try to figure out what is OnPush change detection strategy in Angular. Let's very quickly recap how change detection works in Angular by default. So when the Angular application is being bootstrapped, it creates an instance of zone. The zone is an execution context for Angular applications, and it is needed in order to track asynchronous activity on the page. For instance, it might be handling of some JavaScript event, or it might be something like set interval tick. Once such event happens, zone.js notifies about that Angular, and then Angular starts to perform view checking in the Angular component, starting from the root component, and then does it recursively for the entire view tree. To reduce the amount of unnecessary work exists the change detection strategy on push, which you can activate for every component just by configuring the change detection property and set it to on push. After that, you can see that the view isn't being updated anymore. So what happened and how it works? Well, basically the component with on push change detection strategy enabled says to Angular like, okay, Mr. Angular, I appreciate a lot your attention to my bindings and bindings of my children, but now please don't check them until I explicitly give you a sign, okay? If I decide that my state has changed, I will raise a red flag, and during the next change detection cycle, you can go and check my bindings and bindings for my children. In the real code, the component can be marked as dirty or raising the red flag, we can do by calling the markForCheck method, which comes from already familiar change detector ref. And now you can see, once we called this method, the component view is working perfectly again. If you watched the very first video in this video series about change detection, the behavior might remind you one of the method we used in that first video called detect changes. However, those two are very different, because unlike detect changes method, the markForCheck doesn't trigger view checking or change detection for this component and its children. It just marks the component as dirty for the next change detection cycle. And this next change detection cycle will be scheduled by zone right after all this code from this asynchronous callback is executed. So it marked for check, and right after that, the change detection cycle will be scheduled. So if you are wondering what will happen if you call detect changes method inside this async callback, then you will end up actually with two change detection cycles. The first one will be triggered by detect changes, and it triggers view checking process for this current component and all its children. And the second one will be scheduled by zone.js exactly when this async callback has executed. And then Angular will perform view checking for the entire view tree, starting from the root view and down to all children's. With markForCheck, you will end up only with one change detection cycle, because markForCheck, as I said, doesn't trigger change detection. It just marks component as dirty, and The change detection cycle will be triggered by exactly this async event. But markForCheck method has another trick that you have to know. So if we investigate a little bit the source code of this markForCheck method, you will see that it looks like not only the current component is marked as dirty, but all its ancestors. It is needed because this component might have some parent that also has OnPush change detection strategy enabled. And if we don't mark parent as dirty as well, then there is a chance that Angular will not reach the child and will not check it because it reached the parent. It sees that, okay, it is not dirty. So then I will not proceed with the view checking for its children as well. And in such a way, we missing the view checking for the component that needs to be checked. All right, I hope it's clear. Now let's talk about when we have to call markForCheck method in our Angular components. Should we call it every time when data model of the component changes? Well, yes and no. There is a couple of use cases when Angular marks components as dirty automatically, so you don't have to do it manually. The first use case is when the component state is changing inside the component event handler, because during the compilation phase, Angular will wrap event listeners with a special internal function called wrap listener underscore mark dirty and prevent default. And there inside, you can see that the view where the event happened is marked as dirty. So the user, for example, clicks the button and the component turns automatically dirty as well as its ancestors. And only then, after the event handler is executed, Zone.js will schedule the change detection cycle. Another use case when component turns dirty automatically is when the value of any component input is changing. It happens during the view checking phase when Angular goes through template bindings and updates values. Once it sees that the binding is the component property binding and it has changed, in this case, it marks this child component as dirty as well. So when Angular finishes binding checking for this parent component view, it will start to perform the same thing for its children. So this dirty child will be checked during the current change detection cycle. And here's a small note I would like to mention that when Angular tries to figure out if the input binding has changed, it compares values by reference. Okay, so this is very important because mutated object, they have always the same references, and from Angular point of view, it has not changed. So if you want to provide a new value, you have to change the reference by, for instance, cloning the object or array. And the last use case when you don't have to call markForCheck method explicitly, it is when you use async pipe, because under the hood, async pipe calls markForCheck method every time when new value is emitted into the stream. All right, so this is pretty much everything you have to know about OnPush change detection strategy in Angular. And now I would suggest playing some different scenarios and visualize the change detection process when some of components have OnPush change detection strategy enabled. Let's get started with scenario number one. It is the easiest one, and it is a scenario when all components have a default change detection strategy enabled. So imagine that some async event happens in any of these components. Right after the async task is executed, Zone.js notifies about that Angular. After that, Angular performs recursively view checking for the entire view tree, starting from top and goes to bottom. Scenario number two. Imagine that one of components got the OnPush change detection strategy. If the async event happens outside the page component tree, for example, somewhere in button component, once the event handler is executed, Zone.js notifies about that Angular. Angular starts to checking component views until it reaches the one with OnPush strategy enabled. And if this component is not dirty, Angular will not be checking its view and the view of its children. So it will check only the children of header component and footer component. Scenario number three. The same setup, but imagine that this event caused some changes in app component that changed the input of page component. So in this case, the zone.js sees that, okay, a sync event is completed and notifies about that Angular. Angular starts doing view checking and updates bindings. During the binding update process, it detects that the property name for page component has changed. So it marks the component as dirty and completes the binding check for the rest of the view. Then Angular starts to traverse the children of the app component. It checks header because it has default strategy, right? But then it encounters page component, which has on push change detection strategy, and it is dirty. So Angular will check this component along with all its children because they all have default change detection strategy enabled. Scenario number four. The setup is pretty much the same, but the breadcrumbs component also got an on-push change detection strategy. So event happens, zone.js is aware of it and tells Angular to check views. Angular starts to do that. And as before, during the app component view checking, it detects that the name input of the page component has changed, so it marks that component dirty. And then it proceeds to recursively check child components until it encounters the breadcrumbs component, which has on-push strategy enabled and it is not dirty. So Angular will skip view checking for the breadcrumb component, but the rest of the components will be checked because all of them have default change detection strategy. Scenario number five. All components have on-push change detection strategy enabled, and in my opinion, it is the best setup. So imagine the event was fired inside the slide component. As you know, event handlers in Angular, they're wrapped with a special function that marks for check not only the component where this event happened, but also all its ancestors up to the app root view. After that, again, zone.js notifies Angular about the async event and the change detection cycle is triggered. And then Angular sees that, okay, header and footer components, they have on push change detection strategy enabled and they are not dirty. So I'm gonna skip view checking for those components and their children. And then it sees that, okay, page component is dirty, so I'm gonna check this component and all its children that are dirty or have a default change detection strategy enabled. And finally, let's play the scenario with observable, async pipe, and component input change. So the async pipe subscribes to the observable returned by the get method of HTTP client and in such a way initializes the HTTP call. Under the hood, Angular registers a special handler for the event that is fired when an HTTP call successfully completed, and inside this handler, Angular emits the server response to the observable the async pipe subscribed to. And once async pipe receives this new value, it calls markForCheck method, making the component and its ancestors dirty. After that, zone.js recognizes this async event and, as always, notifies Angular about that. Then, as always, Angular starts to check dirty views, and somewhere during the gallery component binding checking, it sees that, the source property has changed. So, slide component will be marked as dirty as well. So then, once the binding check is done for gallery component, the slide component will be checked as well because during the gallery component view checking process, the slide component became dirty. All right, if you watched until now and if you like how I explain Angular concepts, then you might be also interested in my Angular video courses. And especially I would like to highlight the one about advanced Angular forms. And this is really one of the most advanced and in-depth courses about this topic. Just take a 1 minute to see what you will learn from this course. In just a few easy sections, you will be guided through most of the template-driven and reactive forms features. So you can create two advanced and interactive forms that will impress everyone and leave you feel proud of your work. But that's not all. The course strongly focuses on custom form controls implementation, so you will learn a lot about control value accessor and how it is used by Angular under the hood. You will get to build custom form controls like a rating picker and a simple text editor, both of which support template-driven and reactive forms, as well as, you know, validations and other form control features, of course. In addition, you will master a really complex component in the third section. Here I'm talking about a drop-down component that supports option filtering, multi-selection, and accessible keyboard navigation. With my step-by-step guidance, you will be able to build this advanced form control very easy. Already impressive, isn't it? But even that is not all. In the remaining course sections, you will learn how to create Angular forms dynamically from JSON config and which architecture solution can help make it scalable and maintainable in the future. In the last section, you will learn how to manage validation errors globally, so you can dynamically render error messages for invalid controls without generating a ton of boilerplate in your component templates. So enroll right now and let's take your form building skills to a completely new level. The link to the course and discounts will be in the video description. Alright guys, thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video and you learned something new today. And if so, please share this video with your colleagues and friends in your social media. Also, don't forget to leave your comments and subscribe to my other social media where I post different tips and tricks about Angular and front-end development. Otherwise, I wish you a productive week ahead, stay safe and see you in the next video.